After 3 days of grueling StarCraft II action here at the Intellect Stream Masters, it is time for the final game of group stages. We started in the open bracket, we finished groups A and B yesterday, and we're about to finish group C, and now group D. One final match left, and it's going to be a Protoss versus Protoss Moonglade.
Lots of fun. I love a good PvP.
Your favorite.
It's my favorite matchup in the whole world. And these two players, you know, they are very aggressive, so they could show us a pretty exciting match.
Yeah, this is a rematch from a little bit earlier on, where they did play the opening match of the day, but that was not on our stream or on our stage. So now they go against each other, and as you can see here, the result so far, Moonglade, I know you haven't been following this too closely,
Thank you very much. Pay attention now. All right,
Nocio did go through in first place, which is a fantastic result for him. He's the second European to be playing in the quarterfinals now alongside Lambo tomorrow. All best of fives, remember. That's going to be a cool part of the show tomorrow. But right now, Patience versus Stardust. KK.
Hello.
I like how he listens and answers to the word KK now. KK, let's talk a little bit about this matchup then. So you've seen both of these players been playing for a very, very long time now. Stardust has, of course, been a WCS champion. What are your thoughts when looking at this matchup? Do you see it going one way or the other? Do you think this has been really close?
Well, without having seen the previous series, it's a little bit difficult, but I can only imagine that they're kind of still sticking with the norms of PvP. Stardust, for the longest time, had some crazy builds in Protoss versus Protoss where he would be very, very aggressive, but likewise Patience would as well. And I think we're going to get back to that mentality of you beat me in the first series, but now we're back in the lower bracket and I'm probably going to beat you out. So I'm probably leaning on Stardust here doing pretty well.
What do you think, Mr. Moonglade? Let me ask you this.
Okay.
I think it was really funny because I went to Patience in the crowd here when he was watching a game earlier. Mm. And I said, hey, bro, I didn't manage to catch your game versus Stardust. How did it go? Oh, yeah, it's 2-1, really, really close. I'm like, really close? Or are you just messing with me? And he's like, yeah, really close. And then I'm like, okay, cool, I'll take your word for it. Mm. And then in the winner's interview, I asked Stardust the same thing. And he's like, no, I wasn't close. I lost. So, I mean, why do you think Patience is like that, just being a polite little guy? And how does
that manner that Koreans sometimes exude. Like, they're just like very political. Like, yeah, you know, it's not a big deal. It was a close game. It was very well fought from both sides. So, but clearly it was not.
Let's take Stardust's words then. Let's say it wasn't a close series. Sure. How much does that impact this second time around?
Well, it surely impacts his confidence in a big way. I mean, we spoke a lot about Stardust coming into this and like where he's at. And where is he playing well right now? Is he in a slump? Is it the biggest slump of his career? Your question, is he washed up?
Yeah,
kind of mean, but
he seems a little bit unconfident, like after that last interview. If you saw that, how he didn't feel too comfortable with his position here in StarCraft II, despite being a cheeky fella still. So he'll just do that forever.
Well, looking at the head-to-head stats that I got in front of me too, including the win that Patience picked up earlier, in the last year and a half, bringing in 2014, it's tied 3-3 apiece. They really have traded blows back and forth, and this is the ultimate one too now, moving forward to the quarterfinals. Patience, look at him right now. He's looking pretty calm up there, very composed. I wonder what he's thinking or what's going through his mind.
I'm sure he's pretty confident, to be honest. Yeah. Like, he's been doing very well lately. He's been getting pretty far in tournaments, and I'm sure he's expecting this to be another pretty easy win for him.
What about styles then? We talk a little bit about the styles between the both of them. Are we expecting crazy aggressive games here? You know, Oracle's on the other side of the map, crazy Blink Stalker play, or is this a type of series that you see unfold a lot longer throughout?
I think we could see it, you know, both players being a little bit more careful than they might normally want to be, because it is like the best of three that can cost them the tournament or not, so they might take it back and just play some standard PvP and maybe a little less crazy than what we're used to.
You mean like more defensive Blink players and just trying to
kind of go for three bases, make that army, get the Colossus Death Ball up and running, and have a big fight in the middle of the map.
I wouldn't be surprised in the slightest as well if Stardust tried to throw some curveballs in there because he believes that the previous series went so poorly for him, if he's there. So I was really thinking, because Patience, for all intents and purposes, when we've seen him playing out today, as much as he didn't defeat Nurcho, like his later stages of the games look pretty well rounded out. And if Stardust has lost this kind of position here in StarCraft thus far, then maybe Patience just has the better mechanics going into the late game.
StarCraft can be a really brutal and unforgiving game sometimes, and best of three Protoss versus Protoss, I think, really lightens that up a lot too, right?
You mean lighten up how ruthless it is.
Yeah, yeah.
Make it more. Yeah, I mean, same time, it's also. It's not really like you'd want to have a best of three to determine. You'd rather go to like a much higher sort of rate because of the build orders in this matchup as well. Like what counters what. If you get unlucky with a bad opening twice, you're out of the tournament. So there's a lot on the line here, and it's a very dangerous matchup.
What do you think is the most important part then? I think we're almost ready for this, but what is the most important part of a best of three Protoss versus Protoss? Probably any matchup, best of three, anything. Is it the opening build orders? Is it simple confidence? Adaptation from a previous series?
I think the previous series is going to play a lot into it. How they react to it, how they learn from it, what Stardust is going to do to change things and how he lost those games. Unfortunately, we didn't get to see them, so we don't know, but it's obviously something there that happened that he can maybe fix this time around.
All right, final thoughts then, Claris.
For me, I think in Protoss versus Protoss, don't kill yourself off. Don't get too aggressive. If you think you can't be doing something, stick to your guns, stick back a little bit, and just kind of transition on from there. As much as I would like to lean to Stardust after thinking about him saying that it was going to be a little bit difficult because he's not in a great position, I think probably patience.
With all this imaginary esports dollars that I have in my back pocket here, who should I put it on?
Patience.
Yeah?
Yeah, I think so. I think it might be another 2-1 though.
Okay, well, let's go ahead to the contra team for this one then, for a Protoss versus Protoss to end the evening, to end the group stage. Who else could it really be? It's, of course, Todd and Rotterdam.
Aw, thank you very much, Sean. We're going to do our best to make you proud of us. It's been a long day of StarCraft, and hopefully all of you guys at home have enjoyed it. Everyone in Twitch has been having a blast as well. I've seen the Kappas, I've seen the Kipos. People having a good time, Todd.
Yeah, they are, and we should be as well here with this PvP. You know, we got our show match coming up. Maybe you can take some notes, learn a few things, so but you're not Todd, that pathetic when we play.
Can we just like let it go, Todd? you know what, Todd?
You talked too much for me to let it go.
No, that's not even me, guys. Like, you know what, Todd? I'm gonna say it over here. If we would play right now, I think you would probably beat me.
There you go. Finally, I'm satisfied. I still want to play.
No, he's not satisfied, guys. He's going to keep on going because that's kind of person he is. Anyway, let's just go ahead and hop into the game.
Play the Vic team. That fits you very well.
That's how you get the donations,
though. Muslim side.
Alrighty. Over here on the right bottom side of Terraform, we are looking at the main base of... There we go. Thank you very much, Monk. I love you so much. Because I wasn't actually sure. And Protoss is currently living in America. Definitely wants to win this one, as it's been a while that he had a very good result. It is Stardust. Funka knows us so well. He's like, yeah. As soon as it's not smooth anymore, Funk is like, all right, let me hover over the name tag real quick.
I feel like we're telepathically linked to Funka sometimes.
Absolutely.
You can read our minds.
I have that with Sean sometimes as well, with Apollo. I look at his face and I know what he's thinking, and then he starts smiling.
Well, you guys always want to drink, though. There's no challenge.
Nah, it's not that bad, though. On the left-up side of Terraform, we're looking at the main base of one of the cheekiest guys out there. He's always happy. He's always smiling. It is Patience. It's kind of cool to think that both of these guys made a name for themselves in a DreamHack tournament a long time ago.
Yeah.
Patience didn't win his DreamHack, but he had a magnificent run. And of course, Stardust did win his DreamHack and then had a couple of decent runs. But of course, the biggest victory Stardust ever had was WCS Europe Season 2. Yep. He was phenomenal back then, and he was phenomenal in that PvP final, Todd, that 4-0 victory over Sun.
Yeah, it was very impressive. But he made an interesting tweet, actually. He said, it can be last live match of me. Let's burn everything, include regrets. I'm not sure what it means, but it sounds like every single one of my relationships, though, ended.
Which relationships, though?
Exactly. There was not much to burn. And a lot of regret, actually.
Pro Scout over here. Stardust was just checking for proxies. Didn't even check on the left side of his main base for proxies, which is where you often see the Zealot Stalker proxy. PvP is always a joy, guys. It can be very fun. I know it can be a little bit boring if you don't play Zerg or Terran, but we are going to try to do our best to give you guys all the insights of what a beautiful matchup PvP can truly be.
Yeah, they had a game actually on this map earlier in their previous series. I think it was the first one back then as well. And they both went up to three bases. They were playing, you know, Colossus, Standard and all that. But I think Patience just handled the game a lot better in general. You know, when they started attacking, moving around, and there was some sort of a base trade going on as well, Patience just was a lot more solid in general with it. So I fully expect him to try and basically repeat here. the way the first series went, where Stardust this time around is going to have to do better, clearly.
I want to give a small mention there. Stardust started up a Zealot for quite a bit, and then he cancelled it. I guess that Zealot is kind of like, if you proxied me further away than where I scouted, I will let this Zealot finish, and it's going to be more than fine for me.
Yeah.
But if I don't see anything walking into my main base, that means I haven't been proxied. So this way, he just saves himself a couple of minerals. It's the smallest edge that you can possibly get, but in PvP, sometimes the smallest things can actually make the difference.
But Stardust left the base of Patience there way before the Mothership Core was going to be out, so that's a big mistake. He spotted that fast targets very quickly if he had stayed there. Now, I really like this, to be honest. When you open fast target like this, I feel like you're in good shape against pretty much everything, except maybe if you get cheesed and died very quickly.
Yeah, a three gate sometimes can be pretty hard to deal with. Patience gonna open up with Phoenixes, actually, not an Oracle. I do like this thought. You know that I'm a big fan of Phoenix myself in PvP. Stardust went for one gate into Robo, and that's a very unique build. That's a build you don't see very often at all. Most of the time when you see one gate into Robo, there's a Nexus in between as well.
But why does he get a Twilight Council right behind this? This is a bit weird. I'm guessing he's gonna have two gates now, and it's gonna make a little bit of sense, but he starts a fourth pine on.
Yeah, I'm actually super surprised by the build of Stardust. This is
That's like a Terran build.
This is not a normal build at all for a PvP, and that's mostly just because of the timing of the Robo. If he would have got the Twilight Council quicker, then it's all fine. What is he going to get here? A very quick Observer? Maybe he's just like, you know what, I'm going to try to make the read of a lifetime and hope that my opponent opens up with Dark Templars, and I will look like an absolute genius if he does. But
I think he figured he wasn't going to get cheese, so he was like, I don't need the extra gauge just yet. So in the end, he's just like a one base blink play, which is good against almost anything except a very quick expansion, which in this case he's not facing. So I think he's going to be happy to see Phoenix is there.
Mm-hmm. But the quicker the blink, the better, though, Todd. And normally you can get a Twilight before the Robo. The Robo did not get scouted, by the way, by the Phoenixes. So Patience has absolutely no idea on how far blink is possibly in. He might actually think it's a lot further down than it is, because there is a Robo, which he's not aware about.
Three Phoenixes there is the number Patience going to be stopping at, and I think it's a good number.
Oh, he wasted a Graviton Beam. Actually, these units won't be there in time. That's a silly mistake, man. But energy is important.
He just wanted that probe to get away.
Nah, he could have just chased it. It would never get away. That's like running away from a helicopter when you're being chased in the streets of LA, Todd.
Not everybody has that Roddy Micro, man. then you go into internal.
No. Yeah, and then there's like two cop cars in the end of the tunnel. What are you going to do then?
Then you go in the sewers.
No, there's a golden rule, Todd. Once the helicopter shows up, that's when you will give up. Before that, just run. Just kidding, guys. Don't follow my advice. So just three Phoenixes over here for Patience. I like that. You're going to get Immortal as quick as possible as well. If I'm Stardust, I actually had a very cool discussion with the German Protoss Terentius yesterday, where I think the best thing you can do as a Blinkstalker player against Phoenixes is just expand as quick as possible. Stardust's expand is a little bit late, because if I'm Patience right now, Todd, you know what I do? I move forward immediately. As soon as I have my first Immortal, I force the fight. I walk down this ramp and I force the fight, because with one Immortal you can already fight against Stalkers.
Yeah,
he has some gateway units as well, right?
Yeah, not just that many. He only had one Sentry and
but
one
still
Stalker.
He should just run forward and
two
lift
Immortals
up.
Yeah, that is a lot.
Just run forward, Patience, with have faith in your Immortals. You don't even have to be patient.
He can't wait for the Photon of the Charge to be on, because then he will kill Stalkers.
No, he should just go, because he's not going to kill Stalkers. Stardust is going to back off because he realizes he can't fight this. People underestimate the strength of Immortals for sure. This is how I win the majority of my PvP.
Oh, the Observer! Start. Oh, wow. I thought he was going to pull back too early, but that last shot. Beautiful.
Like, if he flies forward now and he lifts up three Stalkers, what is Stardust ever going to do? Fight with five Stalkers against two Immortals and two Stalkers? That's absolute suicide.
Yeah, I think he'd try to snipe the Phoenixes, probably. But he wouldn't have enough firepower to take them out very quickly. That he'd keep his Stalkers alive and snipe them quickly. So, you're right. I think he could have gone for it, but maybe he didn't see the exact numbers of Stalkers and he thought that he might lose some of his Phoenixes, and he wants to keep them alive, I guess.
Mm-hmm. But like 99% of the time, I would say it's a correct call. And it's actually one of my favorite things in PvP, because traditionally people like to think like, hey, Twilight against Target is pretty good, right? But I think if you play Phoenix correctly, it definitely doesn't have to be rough for you.
Did you hear Stardust's interview, actually?
Nope.
He talked a lot about how he discovered that he's a gambler, and he applied that to his PvP. He said, now I really don't mind gambling, you know, rolling the dice a little bit. And in this case, I feel like if this had been Stardust with the Phoenixes, he would definitely have gone for it and, you know, try to get a little bit lucky.
It's funny that you bring that up, because right before I walked to the casting room, Stardust is like, hey, Roddy, and he calls me over. I was like, oh, wow, this is pretty cool. He's going to ask me something about PvP, you know, so like, chest forward, you know, does a breathe off the dust, the dust of my shoulders. I was like, hey, what's up, Stardust? He's like, when you play poker, what limits do you play? I was like, that's what you're thinking of? Like 10 seconds before you're heading into your best of three? Was like,
and what did you say?
I said 1-2.
No, you should have told him the truth about years ago when you played poker and you four table no limit 25 with four buy-ins.
Well, I mean, but that's smaller than 1-2.
Yeah.
That's 0.25. Either way, I like this a lot by Patient as well. I think this is very smart, Todd, because this is very difficult to defend for Stardust right now. These Immortals, they represent so much firepower. So he has to make a decision. Do you have Photon Overcharge in the natural? And if he does that, Patient can fly into the main base again and lift up a bunch of probes with the Phoenixes. This is actually so cool, because I've been playing a lot of PvP on Terraform, and I think that would have been the correct way to go at it. But he doesn't do it. It's a shame. Because like you have to make a decision as Stardust. Either you keep your units in the natural, or you know, you don't Photon Overcharge your natural, you Photon Overcharge your main base, but then you have to fight against four Immortals while you only have one or max two Immortals yourself. So I kind of felt, as he gets another Observer Snipe, well done there by Patience. I think Patience could have done slightly more with the position he was just in.
He's getting a much earlier Colossus deck here, though, and I think he's going to start a third base in a second. He's doing a... I don't think we can call that a contain. He's gonna get some more. Oh, I was gonna say some of his Phoenix Snipe, but somehow gets out of there.
Yeah, Phoenixes, of course, are not armored units, so they don't take extra damage from Stalkers. That's why they can be quite okay. It takes a lot of shots from Stalkers to kill a Phoenix, and right when I say that, these Stalkers blink forward and kill two of the three Phoenixes. But you know that happens. I think they kind of.
Oh, you're
did
right. Everybody knows that, man. They would have died much faster.
I still think it was okay-ish for Patience. I do think he missed a small window. I think he could have done a little bit more when he was threatening to attack. But other than that, he's played solid. He has quicker Colossus stack. He's going up to three bases a little bit quicker as well.
What's this proxy pylon down there for? From Patience at the bottom.
I have no idea. It's always nice to have a little bit of map presence.
I guess he wants to check both bases, like if they go up, whenever the third base is going to start here out of Stardust, fully knowing that he's going to have his much earlier.
Does he see... No, he doesn't see that army moving across the map, but it's so weird for Stardust. Like, I know Stardust has an army supply advantage at the moment as we speak, but he is down in the Colossus count.
I think he's going to go into the natural with the Stalkers and try to get a cancel or a snipe on that third base there. Remember, he has recall with his main army and the Stalkers have blink to get out. You can't even use Hallucination to blink into the main.
Shout out to Patience's main base, by the way. That's a very tricky base to blink into. Like, the moment you walk past that little Fonda point, it's going to be very difficult for you to get out. So once the Stalkers blink in, he's pretty damn committed. The Robo is very well protected as well. But Stardust is going to try to make some plays. Templar Archives is also a pretty solid building to snipe. He wants to go for the Robo, but...
Oh, he recalls with everything, so that third base is going to be exposed there against the Immortals. And Mothership Core, which is going to look for the snipe. And I think they might be able to get it quite easily.
Yep, of course he's going to have to recall as well. Stardust has to be careful and he has to go very quick. Does he still have high ground vision?
They're moonwalking.
Yeah, no high ground vision anymore for Stardust. Two Immortals are left behind as well.
He can walk in a High Templar and feed back the Mothership Core.
That would be a play indeed, Todd. Okay, wow. I kind of like that though by Stardust. Yes, maybe he could have right-clicked on the Nexus and he could have got it, but he's gambling. And like you said, if one High Templar is being wiped in, he would end up losing everything. So
he just told us it was his gambler career. It's part of it.
That's true. He didn't go all in there. That was a check call. That's what it was.
His references. I wonder how many people actually get that.
Everybody knows a little bit of Poketon.
I guess. Second Robo is already up. There for Stardust, so he's pumping out Colossi 2x2 here. He needs to do a little bit of catching up because we've got 5 there for Patience, who's all out of it, man. He wants to go for an attack.
Stalkers counterattacking again. Two Immortals were left behind, but just two Immortals without any Zealots will actually die against 7-8 Stalkers. Stalkers get a Colossus as well. What a great little counterattack here by Stardust. So now Patience is the one that's super committed to this, but this is not a moment where Patience doesn't want to be in this position. He's forced to warp in 3 defensive Stalkers. If Stardust is able to land a feedback on that money. Oh, he doesn't have a Templar Archive yet.
Army-wise,
we
got 88 here for Patience against 78 for Stardust, who's going to try to hold on, uses the Photon Overcharge. Patience is going to get out of there, and he's going to go for the third base, and I think he's going to realize pretty quickly that the probes were evacuated.
The army is a lot stronger, though, from Stardust. He has a lot of Immortals. He has 2 Immortals more, and he is even in the Colossus count, so I kind of like his army a little bit better. He's also up 8 workers, even though he lost that Nexus, so that's a little bit unfortunate. But that's
down one base now. And he's going to restart it elsewhere. A cheeky third base there on the top right-hand side with the probes already being there. Six pylons as well, so he knows that he has got quite a few minerals and cast and wants to spend it. These stalkers, they've been pretty cost-effective,
yeah,
man.
Yeah, they've been great. They've been absolutely phenomenal. He killed two Immortals and a Colossus, are you kidding me? And a bunch of probes. And he forced in a defensive stalker weapon. This is great.
There's still one stalker in natural. Patience finally going to go down, but not before getting, I think he got one more kill there on the probes.
It's still a dead even game, guys. Like, I know it looks like Patience is maybe pulling ahead a little bit, but Stardust can absolutely turn this around. He has much quicker plus three. He's pumping out two Colossus at a time. He's rebuilding his third base. He's going to get his own Archons. Yeah. I know Stardust is down 20 supply. But
I don't know why Patience is not taking the gases on the third, by the way.
I don't get that either. I like Stardust's position. If he makes it through the next 2 minutes of this game, I think he's going to win. He's up 13 workers. He has a stronger army. He's going to have plus three. A feedback would be magnificent. Come on, man. Have a single High Templar. Yeah, there we go. High Templar's being warped in from downtown.
Time Warp is about to go down, though. Here we go. I think Stardust is in a bit of trouble. Boom. He's going to go for the fight. Feedback hits, and no Time Warp before that.
Yeah, the Colossus are a little bit clumped up though for Stardust, so he's taking a lot of damage. There are so many Zealots in the mix as well. This may have actually been Patience's moment, where if they fought right here and right now, Patience is going to be able to crush this army of Stardust. Stardust came so close and was so close to pulling pretty far ahead, but Patience said, no, we're going to fight right here and right now, because in this moment, I have way more Zealots than you, and I've got charge, and I'm going to go for it. Didn't land Time Warps, but he was still able to get the job done.
I really like the two-pronged attack there. Came in from two sides. I feel like if he had clumped everything up and went straight, it would have been a lot harder for Patience to actually pull this off. But in the end, a pretty well-conducted game, and even though the Stalkers were annoying in the end, I guess he had too much.
Yeah, the Colossus were a little bit clumped up for Stardust as well. Stardust looking a little bit flustered. He will have a couple minutes to think about what went wrong in game number two, as we're going to head over to a very small break, and after that, we'll be back with potentially the last game of the day. Alrighty guys, welcome back to day three of the Intox Remasters Cologne, where we're getting closer and closer to finding out who is going to be the last player to complete our top eight. Todd, at least one Protoss.
Yeah, one more.
No, at least one.
It's the only one, yeah. I heard you talking about it earlier.
Yeah, I mean, this is great news for all of us guys, because if there wasn't a single Protoss in the top eight, Todd would have left us tomorrow and the day after to cast some Heroes of the Storm.
Who says I won't?
I know you won't, Todd. As long as there's a Protoss somewhere around to be casted, I know you will always be there. Spacians took a 1-0 lead. Pretty cool game, though. I enjoyed it, Todd. It was a pretty dynamic PvP. I thought the counterattack with all the Stalkers was great. I wouldn't say it was flawless play, but pretty damn high-level PvP.
To be honest, going into this tournament, there wasn't that many Protosses.
I know it wasn't exactly Intel Extreme Masters Shenzhen.
who cancelled sadly? Yeah, Shenzhen and
yeah, you
San Jose, man. If you send Hero and Rain to the same tournament, you're pretty sure they will make it far.
Well, you know Shenzhen, right? We had Hero, Rain, Classic, and Parting. and even First, we had First as well. This is such a sick Dream Protoss lineup. Either way, one of these two Protosses is going to make it to the quarterfinals and perhaps even further, even though that's quarterfinals is going to be very tough. On the left top side of this map, we're looking at the blue Protoss once more. I believe it is Stardust. I like his t-shirt, Todd. A little bit of cardboard animation love. Nothing wrong with that. I'd rock it.
And so would I.
And over here in the right bottom side of Coda, we're looking at the main base of the man who's up 1-0. It is Patience.
Playing for Team Dead Pixels here with his teammate Fantasy. They actually, you know, like it's funny, like in most of those teams, like it doesn't feel like the players are like super close, but Fantasy's been hanging around a lot around Patience, giving advice here between games. Mm-hmm. Maybe if not for this series because it's PvP. Like he'd walk over, he's like, you know what, I actually really can't help you, so you're on your own.
No, he walks over, he's like, trust me, man, pick Terran. Like, Reaper expanded into Bio. I've played against Stardust last week, you can't deal with it. And the patient's like, I don't know, man, I don't think this is looking all that good. Let's go for it, man, gas first, we don't mind Rob. It's like, I've been watching this American Terran stream and Atanias, he approves of it as well. Like, yeah. I think you got it.
If a build gets Nathanias approved, then it's definitely a good one. And usually anything that includes dirty Widowmine drops is in there.
Pretty quick double gas over here. Patience did it a little bit different. It's always, you know, like people still ask about like what's the main difference between a double gas and then a single gas, and then you get your second gas a little bit later. I'm still old school, Todd. I take my gases one by one.
You mean one and then Cybercore, then the other gas?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. You do it every game?
Yes.
Why did you reveal that to me?
Why?
Oh. There's some several weaknesses to that, I think.
Why, you're going to steal my gas? Try it. Try it. I dare you. I double dare you.
Against the Gateway 11?
I double dare you.
I think it was Patience there that saturated his gases a little bit earlier. Mm-hmm. So he's got a little bit more here to work with. And usually that kind of makes me think of a Stargate, but I don't think we should read too much into it here, because obviously he's going to have to get most likely a Stalker, Mothership Core, and Warpgate before, unless he goes for a Sentry, in which case a lot of the time he's going to be for a Quick Nexus.
I think it's going to be Twilight against Twilight this map.
Okay.
Because I feel both players are pretty confident in their Blink Stalker abilities. No Stargate Arena, Twilight against Twilight.
All right.
We'll see. Maybe I'm right, maybe I'm wrong. So far it looks like I'm right, Todd.
Yeah, both players just going to start the standard Stalker. And Mothership Core, I think Patience Target.
No, Patience Twilight. It's a guessing game. Of course, Coda has a map where you can play both Twilight and Stargate, and neither is necessarily right or wrong. The first Twilight console is done, and that is for Patience. Second Stalker is on the way for Stardust, so I'm expecting him to get a Twilight console as well.
Usually, if you get the Stargate, you get it a bit earlier. I don't think it makes sense to start it this late. It's kind of bad.
Well,
Actually, though, imagine if you do that, then the timing is off. And the other guy doesn't expect it.
Yeah, sometimes things like that can work. This Mothership Core could potentially end up in a little bit of trouble, because I believe the
ships.
Stalker is on the north side. That's the Stalker, right? Or is that a probe? Yeah, come on, chase it down. We don't have enough energy yet for a recall. No, 80. Ooh, that's Stalker. I'm actually a little bit sad that Stardust didn't go via the right side with the Stalker, because I think he would have been able to chase it down. Maybe not kill it, but at least get some real damage done, not just shield damage.
Yeah. And in this case, it is going to get away, but Patience gets absolutely no info. Stardust flying across the map. There's going to be one Stalker waiting for this. And a second one about to come out. He might be able to get the info. Oh, actually, he gets found on the map.
Yeah, access denied, mate. Access denied. These Mothership Core.
Oh, he's going to go right back in. Look at this. Stardust, just like in poker, not hesitating, going forward.
You know, this is where this whole, whenever Todd is casting and I'm not around, he always likes to make jokes about rotting Mothership Cores and them dying in the middle of the map. But the true origin of that story is that I explained to Todd that I like getting Stalkers early on because of scenarios like this. Some people fly out with their Mothership Core and you can actually catch it in the middle of the map and then you can kill it. And I think both players, what's going on over here? Oh, a little bit of first person, is that what we're looking at? Wow, these Protoss players are very fast. Oh, okay. Oh, we just had a random wipe. All right, I have no idea what's going on anymore, Todd.
Pylons are being proxied on the map there for Patience, so it looks like he might want to be aggressive with this. He cut Mineral Probes at 18, and he's getting the Robo back at home. So apparently, he's already thinking that there's going to be a good chance that Stardust wants to expand there, and I think he wants to be aggressive onto it.
That was so funny. I actually thought we just scene switched to first person view of Patience, and you just saw like 3 APM in the first 10 seconds. I was like, oh god, no, the Protoss mine. It's going to be out of control.
If it was Elfie, it would have been unbelievable.
Either way, it is going to be, Blink is going to be finishing off for both players right now. Of course, no...
Why is Patience sending out two probes out of this main? Okay, now he wants to start a Nexus.
Yeah. I mean, most of the time when you're doing the exact same build, then it's just all about expanding. You don't want to be that stubborn Protoss that goes overly aggressive. Stardust is going to move out now because he knows he could potentially fight here with an Immortal, and his opponent doesn't have an Immortal, but of course he has to walk up a ramp. He's going to try to chase it down, but neither player making any micro errors so far. Patience wants to get a Cheeky Stalker kill, but he's not getting one.
You know what Stalkers against Stalkers make me think of?
Tell me.
Is Sengoku and Vegeta at the fight.
What? Who?
Sengoku and Vegeta.
Why did you call him Sengoku? Everyone just calls him Goku.
Well, full name, man. I don't know. You're like, that's such a weird question as well.
You know, like, I had no idea what you're saying. I was like, Sangria? I was like, well, what?
No.
I thought it's this. Sengoku. Yeah. Why?
And Vegeta, because they blink all over the place, man.
Because they're so fast. Oh, yeah, they blink mid-air. Yeah, that's true. A little bit of Dragon Ball Z
reference. They don't quite hit nearly as hard, though. Quite the opposite. More like Krillin. Tiny anyway, shots.
Stalkers are like Piccolo. They fight for days and then nothing dies.
And they don't repair themselves if they die or lose an arm or leg.
Well, the shields regenerate a little bit.
Yeah, I guess.
A little bit. All right, the Robo Bay is going down.
We're not nitpicking there, Roddy, are we?
Observer, how many observers are we looking at on both players? So Stardust has two observers. I kind of like that. One with your army and one still to take a look on the what's happening on the other side of the map.
Yeah. I feel the opposite here of the previous game in regards of, you know, getting a Forge in Colossus. It's Stardust that's much, much, much earlier.
Ooh.
And I think Patience might have picked up on that. That's why he wants to be aggressive, because he warped in a bunch more Stalkers. He's on 10 against 8. But we actually have 3 sentries there for Patience with quite a bit of energy.
He wants to make something happen over here. Stardust went for a Robotics Bay very greedy. Where's that Mothership Core of Stardust? It should be in position right here. I have a really hard time imagining that Patience wants to run up this ramp. But if he does, I'm not saying that it's the wrong play. Not at all, actually. If he force wheels out these Immortals, oh my god, he would have been able to kill this Nexus with ease. Now it's going to be a little bit more difficult. He's still going to try it, though, Todd, with all these force fields. Interesting play here by Patience. Stardust not expecting this at all. Because
3 force field demo out.
No one would ever expect this. I would go for the Nexus right now. Just go for the Nexus.
He went really far. I think he might just pull back there and be happy with the little damage that he's done.
I mean...
That's a huge commitment, man.
Yeah, I know, but I'm going to roll the dice a little bit, Todd. You know what they say, gambling isn't fun if it doesn't hurt. I'm losing a couple stocks.
You're sick.
Well, first Colossus is on the way right now for Patience, but now, you know, overall that was okay-ish for Stardust. It was supply block for a split second, but that's not the end of the world. He's going to get a much quicker Colossus count. Of course, by the time that you run across the map on Coda, maybe...
Oh, the probe hit squad.
Yeah, 4 Stalker hit squad.
You want to kill some probes. Maybe it's time for Pig to take notes. Mm-hmm.
It's hard to capitalize on any Colossus advantage, though, on Coda, because I feel most of the time when you run across the map, your opponent has caught up in the Colossus department. You agree?
Yeah.
So I guess
where is this going, though? Like, it feels like both players, they kind of just
three base
camp on 2 base for now.
I think Patience is going to go up to 3 bases pretty much immediately.
It really feels like Patience really wants to attack, but then every time he realizes that it's not going to work, so he ends up expanding against his will. Like, he's like, oh, okay, I guess I'll go for a Nexus.
But this reminds me a little bit of watching Gong Fu Banda against the French Protoss that we were watching the other day, Todd, where it's just one guy who always DNS, where one guy just always has map control, has all the vision. Look at Patience's vision, and a little bit on the north side, a little bit on the south side, keeps check of the army. He's going to blink into the main base right now because he sees that his army is out of position. That is his call. Well done, Patience, playing some really solid PvP. Just go for it, matey. This is your moment. How far away do you want these units to be? Patience!
Oh, he's setting up on the right-hand side. I think he wants the entire army to be sent back to the main here to defend for this. Wily will set up on the right-hand side for the cancel on the Nexus, which, by the way, hasn't started yet.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I think he should have just gone for probes. Now he only killed 3 probes. I really felt he could have killed 7 or 8. He wasted so much time there.
Yeah, and also he's going to get to the third base and see that there is no third Nexus and say, Sacre bleu, man.
Sacre bleu. Do you really think that's what he says? Out of all the possible things that Patience could say on that moment,
maybe not.
It would be Sacre bleu.
Oh, this Colossi.
I think Stardust just wants to go for a 2-base all-in.
Yeah.
Which is so weird. No one does that on this map normally, but it could actually work.
That's why it will surprise, man.
The cheesiest thing a cheesy player could do, Todd, is all-in. Nobody expects it.
I mean, he kind of pretended that we're sticking a 3rd base, and I think right now, Patience is about to realize the trickery that took place. Do we go into a base trade? No, Stardust knows that he's too far away to actually go for that. Patience, he might have to recall there. No, they... Yeah, we go for a base trade there.
It could be, indeed. Patience has to be very careful, though, about how he wants to go at it, because I feel
it's
that
it's much better for him. I think he can snipe the Nexus there and then recall in his main. Stardust hesitating. He's walking back now.
Stardust is so indecisive.
Oh, the Mothership Core is so far away. Yeah, forget it.
Oh, my God. The army could get trapped. And I think it's actually going to get trapped. Well, there it comes. Oh, the Stalker. Stalker should see it. Kill that Mothership Core.
They don't see it right now. Well, if he can recall with just the Colossus, it's enough already.
No, he's going to kill it. No, he's not going to kill it, but he does get a Colossus. Oh my God, that was close.
Hashtag not a rowdy Mothership Core. Gets out this time.
My heart's
good. I can't believe he didn't get the Nexus, by the way. I thought it was the first thing. I think he panicked. Like he saw.
Yeah, of course.
He's like, oh my God, where is my Mothership Core? I lose everything.
That was just wild, because during all that, Patience did kill a Colossus, though, Todd. He may have not killed the Nexus, but he did kill a Colossus of Stardust as well. Stardust has charge. Patience absolutely does not have charge, correct?
No, oh,
he does. Damn it. But Stardust has +2, and that helps a little bit. But yeah. +2 is going to finish up almost for Patience as well. Now Stardust is getting his own Templar Archives, but this is just all taking
that's
a little
really
too long, man. Like, if you want to go 2-base all in, it's got to be fast. You got to be decisive, and you just got to go for it.
You should watch your stream more, man.
I don't really.
It's just a bit slow.
I don't really all in a whole lot in PvP, though. Todd. These are the mind games I'm playing on you. Actually, all in all the time.
Kappa.
Couple Zealots being warped in. I mean, Stardust could still make this happen. What's the Colossus count at? It's 3 against 4. Four against four. Where's Colossus number 4 for Stardust, though? I only see 3.
He has one more Immortal as well. He's just behind. Yeah, okay. Regrouping right now. He's gonna try to get a good fight. I think between those 2 bases, if he's able to do that.
Yeah.
But Archon count though. 0-3 right now.
But Templar Archons is finishing up for Stardust, so maybe he's going to get his own Archons. Yep, there we go. He's going to get 3 Archons himself. Stalkers are going to try to get a... It's so hard to attack on Coda.
Yeah.
I hope...
100 to 102 army supply, Roddy. It's going to be so close.
Yeah, but I mean, like, Patience has defender's advantage. Maybe a Photon Overcharge. I like this one, Zealot, forcing a defensive warp in. He got 5 kills, and that makes Stardust extremely committed. One of the Colossus is not fighting from Stardust. Oh, it was fake Colossus. Doesn't really matter. But it still feels like it's an okay...
One Archon is not fighting here for the longest time. He's finally going to get in there, but the Concave by Patience was set up beautifully, and he's going to have way more tanking at the front there. His Colossus and Immortals are going to do the job behind this. Stardust, I think he's out of it. Patience will move on here to the round of 8 with this great hold against these 2-base all in from Stardust. Grats, good game.
A very solid hold. GG is called as Patience will be the only Protoss player advancing and completing our top 8 at the Intox 3 Masters Cologne. Well done. Good job by him. Good hold in the end there. And Stardust, just a little.